Okay, our final speaker is Kriti Sharma. She's associated with the Council for Social Development, Hyderabad, India, as a legal researcher. Over the last 2 years, she has been working on legal sensitization of Koya and Chanchun tribal communities in the states of Telangana as part of the Ford Foundation project, which includes training tribal advocates, handling live cases, and paralegal programs. A significant focus has also been on raising awareness in law schools through designing constitutional law course on tribal questions, organizing national moot and workshops. As a follow to her work, a practice guide to tribal advocacy will be published this summer. The floor is yours.
Good morning. Good afternoon. First of all, I would really like to thank AYLH for giving me an opportunity to present here. And my special thanks to Professor David Skuer and Professor Ron Harris. Both of their work I really admire. We Indians tend to speak really fast, so in case you want to slow me down, just raise your hand and I will slower my pace. It's nice to know that a lot of you here find interest in the subaltern studies in India, and I'm particularly interested in looking at indigenous communities. Now, the Indian Constitution guarantees a special architecture of rights. It has affirmative action and special provisions. Also, it allows tribal autonomy, territorial autonomy in governance for the tribal people. However, in reality, despite the effort of a large cohort of people, there is still a lot of structural violence, disentitlement, and chronic vulnerabilities due to bureaucratic governmentality that is present in India. My specific interest is on the historic conditions of indigenous tribes who continue to face unabated exploitation despite their resistance, and also the situation of indigenous women within these communities who continue to face under colonialism and neocolonialism, they are further entrapped in gender hegemonies. Now, although there are a lot of studies in India on indigenous communities, the specific vulnerabilities of tribal women have not been focused on. These vulnerabilities are against the state and the larger community in general, as also within their own community. This is despite the fact that they constitute around half of 104 million tribal population in India, and they actually fall behind even the Muslim minorities and also the Dalit or the lower caste women in India. So if I hope you're all in... okay, this is not my slide. Sorry. Okay, how do you enlarge and control F? Control plus?
I think you can use and try control and
okay. So if you are interested in labor and migration, there are a lot of interesting studies happening around the world on migration. Recently, apparently, the Chinese government found a lot of Chinese migrants were taken to Colorado for labor work in mines and railways. I read a long time ago, and Karl Marx said that the capitalism is based with the hands of the blood of children. And I recently learned from a Calcutta professor about child labor happening, the children being taken from England to Canada for child labor, and the Canadian courts have addressed this problem in some of the judgments. Also, what is interesting is the migration is accentuated on account of tribe, gender, and poverty. So this is the Chota Nagpur Plateau in India. It's presently in the state of Jharkhand. And how do I go?
Something is my...
It's okay, I'll have to.
And it's not the...
I'm sorry. Okay, so... I can't do something, just click.
Maybe this is not a presentation, I think. It's just the pictures themselves.
Excuse me. Yeah, and... Okay, basically there are four tribal people. I had a picture of all of them because they are very different. They're from Proto-Australoid group, which is the same as the Aboriginals in Australia, and also the Andaman and Nicobar tribes. And they're four in number. There is Munda and Santals, which are the largest tribal communities in India, around 7 million. 7 million, and then there are Kho and Kharia, who are only around 70,000 odd in numbers. So what happened in 18th century, as is generally a typical case of colonization in India, that the British started to rule this area first through an indirect rule, which is through the rulers, present king, and then later through Permanent Settlement Act, they directly control the administration and the governance, and they introduce the formal legal system that is present. What did this this conquering entail for the tribal people? It entailed a lot of policy-induced famines. If you're aware of the work of economist Amartya Sen, he's argued that famines were not just because of environmental condition, but it was how the British handled it. I mean, they were more interested in exploiting and taking the goods back to Britain instead of focusing on what was happening within these areas. It also entailed the beggar system. Around 130 villages, the people were taken to work for the public works like railways, roadways, etc. In midst of this poverty, there were tribal rebellions, two or three strong ones, but they were brutally quashed by the British through ammunitions. So the tribal people in these conditions, they decided to move eastwards in search of employment. And there in Assam Valley, which is... So this is, I'll just make do with this picture. This is Assam Valley, if you see. This is upper part of Assam Valley. Now, the British were really interested in tea plantation, and the Chinese had a monopoly of it. And what happened is that in around 1840s, they found wild tea growing in Assam. So they were really excited, and they quickly took over all the chiefs there and started to encourage British people to grow plantations through Simple Fees Act and lease system, which made it very easy to take land. But plantation is very labor-inducive. You require a lot of labor. And the Chinese people were really not interested in coming down. And the local tribal population was considered too lazy by the British. So what they did was they got people from the Chota Nagpur Plateau to come and work there. Initially, it was just unlicensed system. Then they started to have this Sardari system, which is recruitment through contact. So there will be certain local plantation laborers who would be given certain amount of minimal money to go back and hire the whole families to come to these plantations to work. Now, this was really good for British planters because A, it was cheap to get a whole family, and plantation is a lot of work for the women. The tea plucking is done by women, around 10 kgs odd every day, even today. They required a lot of women for this. So with the family will come the women, and also the adolescents, because from the age to 15 to 18, you can get them to work and you'll have to pay them even less than half of the money. And also it's cheaper to get them all together, and then they will not run away because they have the families there. So it was a lot of arduous process. It required a few days journey on the boat, and a lot of people died because of malaria and other diseases in Assam. And then the plantations started. However, the British just wanted more and more labor. So around 1863, the Special Act 6 of 1863 was introduced in the area, which allowed them to have the right to private arrest. So if these people did not work according to the demands, they would be punished. And this is interesting because formally in 1833, the British had abolished slavery with anti-slavery law in 1933, but we see world over that different form of slavery is continued in various ways, and this is one of them. And how was this law allowed? Because basically the British planters argued that there were not enough judicial magistrate, and if we bring the case, small cases, to the city, it will take time and it will be a lot of delayed work. And we really don't know actually what was happening on plantations. There is not much account of it. Later in 1906, there was an Assam committee, inquiry committee, which was formed, which asked for repeal of this law. And it mentioned but the accounted cases were only around 240 odd per year. But in reality, this law was being used day in and day out. Something like if you've seen the movie 12 Years of Slavery, the Oscar winner. Yeah, okay. So So in 1906, the inquiry committee highlighted the conditions of these people, but nothing much happened because the labor laws were only introduced in India around 1926. And even then, the laws like Workmen's Compensation Act or Industrial Act did not really apply to plantations. They did not address the kind of accidents that happen on plantation or the conditions of plantation. So much continued till the British left. And then we would hope that there would be transition in law at the time of independence. But freedom was not for all. And in India, they introduced the Plantation Labour Act in 1951, which lays down, purely on paper, it lays down the minimum wage, it lays down health, education, benefits. But if even today you can walk down to the tea plantation and see for yourself the conditions. In terms of minimum wage, the problem is that the trade union lobbies are not that strong in India. And the minimum wage has to be decided between the planters, the government, and the trade unions. And generally, the government and planters collide with each other and try and get them. Even last month when I visited this area, there was protest of 26 trade unions together asking for increase in minimum wages, which is really, really less even in today's time. Specifically for women, it was not until 1976 that there was Equal Remuneration Act that equal pay was given. And even if they are given equal wages, their work is definitely much more harder than the men, because men are supposed to do plucking, which is these are the pictures from British time. It's completely women's work, the plucking. What men are supposed to do is that once you collect the teas, they in the factory sort, they dry it out and they make tea out of it. So the difficult work is, yeah, so the men are always inside, they do the pruning part of the process. Yeah, so essentially the tribal women also don't have breaks for menstruation cycle. They don't have there are a lot of agitations that happen in tea plantation because women are treated wrongly. There are a lot of miscarriages that also happen while they're working. And I did try to see if there was any trade union, if there was a strong representation of their rights or demands, but there wasn't actually much. Although most of the tribal women are part of some trade union, but if you go through the newspaper accounts, you will see a lot of news being reported that so-and-so agitation happened because the woman fainted and the people stopped working and so on and so forth. The other problem is that tea plantation is not a year-round work. There are a few months when there is no work, and then there's a heavy period of work. Depends on the season. So a lot of women are hired as casual laborers or seasonal workers. So they don't get full benefit of the Plantation Labor Act in any case. And there are a lot of adolescents who are mostly women, but they're not counted as women because the numbers are actually a lot higher than it is represented. Now, in this last 100 years, these tribal population have also shifted to Bhutan, to Nepal, to tree plantations in Bangladesh, and also the brick and kiln industry in Calcutta. A lot of them have also fallen into prostitution. I will come back to this point. But essentially, the major problem started in 1990 when the tea industry shrank because they have been using this land for so long and it has become infertile. And also the big tree, India is still the second largest producer of tea. It employs around 2 million people. And at present, 1 million people are on these plantations in Assam. But the major brands like Tetley, Tata, or Lipton, they have focused on the end process of it, that is the branding and repackaging. And they've given these plantations to local planters so that they don't have to follow the proper laws and procedures and take care of what is happening in the plantations. So after 1990, the employment is shrinking for these tribal people, these tea tribes. And furthermore, the local Assamese tribal people, which is the Bodos, they've been asking for an independent state from India. And they have never liked tea planters since the very beginning. It is an Assam Inquiry Committee They say that these tea planters were not allowed to go to the forest or make any permanent settlement because the local tribals really resisted them. And these Bodo people right now have taken arms. They've become insurgent, and there's a lot of massacre that's happening in the tea states. Even last December, there were around 90 odd people killed, and there's generally constant sexual assaults and violence on the women on the tea planters. In this process, a lot of women are leaving the tea tribes, and they're simply, even in the courts, they're simply mentioned as missing tribal cases. In fact, when I was a judicial clerk in Delhi, over a few months, we collected around 100 cases of the tribal women, which we sent to the CBI for investigation. And it seems that they're involved now. They run away from these tea states in search for work to places like Delhi and Calcutta, where they essentially fall into prostitution rackets. Or they go in domestic work. And domestic work is really unregulated in India. There's no minimum wage. There is no regulation of it. So that is a huge problem that we are facing. But India doesn't really focus on its internal migration and the concerns surrounding it. So there's really need for a paradigm shift, and it's for the government to look into the concerns of these women at the moment. The kind of approach that we have of these tribes is also affected by the British thinking of it, because the British were so obsessed with the idea of reforming the white man's burden. They prosecuted whoever did not fall in the normal moral pattern of living. Even in their own country, they were prosecuting the gypsies and so on. So in India, they criminalized these tribes. And with the criminalization of these tribes, the notion that they're criminals and all of that started. And that is still the mainstream notion of these tribal people. And even the judicial or the legislative view is influenced somewhat in this with this thought process. So I hope that now that there's a need for a paradigm shift in the way we deal with the tribal population, because as a famous writer in India, Arundhati Rai, wrote that there is no really such thing as the voiceless. There are only the deliberately silenced or preferably unheard. And these tribal women have really been unheard. However, in their own oral history, they have a lot of memories of what has been happening on them, with them. And one of my colleague, he is actually traveling to these areas collecting the oral history. And he sent me a song yesterday morning, which is generally sung by the tribal people. I couldn't get the subtitle of it, but I will tell you what. I don't know, this is going to take time. It'll only take a minute. Where is it? I don't know. Okay. It's sung by this guy called Ajay Asur, who is from the... It's okay, it's not going to happen.
Do we have sound?
I'll translate it for you in the meanwhile. So basically, Ajay Asur is also... it's okay, never mind. He's also one of the tribals from the Santhal tribe and from the Chota Nagpur plateau, and he sang this song, which is sung by the ancestor during harvesting time, and it roughly translates to. It's really fine. It's fine. It's not in. You can see him and listen to me. So it's essentially translates as, the ancestor land is now finished, brother and sister, let's go to Assam. Once upon a time, this land was ours. Our ancestors cut the tree, they made the villages, they harvested, they grew food. Our life was this land, and we were happy. But today the government took over our land and sold it to the company. The company earlier meant British, and now it's the mineral companies. It left us desolated. Our land is died. Our harvest has died. Now there is nothing left here. Let's go to the foreign land. Thank you.